Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In today's video, I'm going to solve the following problem that I call first player 2 points ahead. We assume that two players that we call A and B play until they are 2 points apart, and we assume that those players are not evenly matched, so meaning that player A and B don't have the same probability of scoring each point. And more precisely, we are going to assume that each point is independently scored by A with probability P and by player B with probability Q. The winner of the game is the first player who is 2 points ahead of the other player, and the goal is to find the probability of this event WA, that is the event that player A wins, meaning again that player A is the first player 2 points ahead of the other player. An example of game where this happens is, for instance, ping pong, where not only the winner must have at least 21 points, but also be 2 points ahead of the other player. So, of course, the problem we are looking at is much simpler than the game of ping pong, in the sense that the requirement of reaching at least 21 points is not there. But assuming, for instance, that two players A and B playing ping pong are, let's say, tied 20-20, then starting from this point, the winner is going to be the first one 2 points ahead of the other one. So one possible technique we can use to solve this problem is to use a conditioning, and a little bit in the spirit of the solution I gave for computing the probability of winning at the game of craps. The idea is going to condition on what can happen at step one, and that's called a first step analysis. So first possibility is to condition on a partition. There is another way to solve the problem, another natural way to solve the problem. It's by using the fact that the probability measure is sigma-additivity. And the idea is going to be to list all the possible outcomes in the event WA that A wins, and then write this event WA as the disjoint union of its outcome, and then argue that by sigma-additivity, the probability of the event WA is going to be equal to the infinite sum of the probability of each of the outcomes. So I'm going to give you both answers. In fact, I'm going to start with the conditional technique, the conditioning technique, and then we'll see how to use instead sigma-additivity. You will see that both proofs are completely different, but obviously we end up with exactly the same answer. So first, let's see how we can solve the problem using conditional techniques. So I'll just quickly remind you that WA is the event that A wins, and that A and B scores independently with probability P and Q. Of course, P plus Q is equal to 1. So the goal of this idea of conditioning is really to compute the probability of WA by conditioning on a partition. So that's we should get something of the form P of WA equals the sum, finite or infinite, over N of the conditional probability of WA given BN times P of BN. And those events BN should form a partition of omega. So meaning that those events should be disjoint, so meaning mutually exclusive, and also the union of all of them should be equal to omega. Now, it turns out that even if this formula is true for all partitions, now our goal is not to just take any partition to solve this. The goal is to really find a, I would say, useful partition, meaning we need to find events BN such that the probability of BN is easy to compute, but also such that this conditional probability is easy to compute. So BN should give us enough information such that given this event, P of WA becomes something easy to compute. And so something natural would be like we did for the game of craps, it's to condition on who scores the first point. Okay, that would be a first natural choice. However, you see that if A scores the first point, then the probability that A is the first player 2 points ahead of the other player, given that A scores the first point, is not something that looks very easy to compute. We can only say that P of WA, given that A scores the first point, should be we believe strictly larger than P of WA, but that's pretty much everything we can say. It's not clear how to compute this quantity. However, if we add one more point and instead we condition on who scores the first 2 points, then it turns out that those probabilities are still easy to compute, and those ones also are extremely easy to compute. Because, well, indeed, if A scores the first 2 points, then the conditional probability given this event of WA is clearly 1. If A scores the first 2 points, then A wins. At the opposite, if B scores the first 2 points, then B wins and P of WA is 0. Now, the nice thing we can use again, it's this idea of having a restart argument and loss of memory. If in all the other cases, so that means that after 2 games, we have A, B, or B, A. If I just call A, B the event that A scores first and then B scores the second point, then in this case, after 2 games, there is a tie. And so the conditional probability that A wins eventually, given that there is a tie at any point of the game, is again equal to the probability of WA, so the unconditional probability. So that's going to be the trick to compute the probability of WA. So concretely, what I'm going to do is use the event BN I'm going to use are basically a collection of 4 events that I'm going to call AA, AB, BA, BB, corresponding to who scores the first 2 points. So we basically condition on the first 2 points, and this sum here reduces to a sum of 4 terms. So we have P of WA given AA times P of AA. Then second term is going to be P of WA given BB times P of BB. And then we have the other two possible sets in our partition that corresponds to a tie after 2 games. So that's going to be P of WA given AB times P of AB, and we still have plus P of WA given BA times P of BA. So now everything here is easy to compute except those two conditional probabilities here. So let me use some red to show you first what we can say about those two conditional probabilities. Well, if A scores the first 2 points, then clearly A wins. So that means that this conditional probability here is equal to 1. At the opposite, if B is the player scoring the first 2 points, then A loses. And so that means that this conditional probability is 0. Then clearly, because each point is scored independently by A with probability P, that means that this probability here is P squared, this one is Q squared, following the same spirit, and here we are going to have a probability PQ and this one QP, they are both equal to PQ. And so eventually you can really simplify the expression and say that P of WA is going to be equal to this 1 times P squared plus 0 times Q squared. Here you have each time PQ, I'm going to write plus 2PQ, because it turns out that indeed those two conditional probabilities are equal. So this is where we use this idea of restart argument and loss of memory. It doesn't matter that the conditioning event is AB or BA. After 2 points, after they play twice, there is a tie between the two players. And so nobody won so far. And so that means that the probability of the conditional probability of WA given a tie after two games. It would be the same after four games, six games, eight games, and so on. Is equal to the unconditional probability P of WA. This follows from the fact that there is indeed loss of memory. You can forget about the first two games, and it's like the two players have to restart the game. And so that means that those two probabilities are equal to P of WA. And so from that we can conclude. So I'm going to erase this now, and so now we conclude that P of WA is equal to this expression here. So you can simplify. So let me write that this is the same as P of WA. And so that means that 1 minus 2PQ times P of WA. 1 minus 2PQ times P of WA is going to be equal to P squared. And so from that you deduce that P of WA is equal to P squared divided by 1 minus 2PQ. So that's a possible answer. I don't really like this form. In fact, you can not simplify but change this expression a little bit, using the fact that P plus Q is equal to 1, and then you can rewrite this 1 minus 2PQ in a different form. So, because P plus Q is equal to 1, you get that, so of course P plus Q squared is equal to 1, but then P plus Q squared is also equal to P squared plus 2PQ plus Q squared. So this tells you that 1 minus 2pq, this quantity here, is equal to p squared plus q squared. So p squared divided by p squared plus q squared. And so that's eventually the probability that A wins, the probability that A is the first player 2 points ahead of the other player, is going to be equal to p squared divided by p squared plus q squared. You see, this has some interesting interpretation. You can think of this quantity exactly as the probability that A scores twice in a row divided by probability that A scores twice in a row plus the probability that B scores twice in a row. You see also that obviously if the two players were evenly matched, without any calculation, we could guess that because of perfect symmetry, the probability that A wins should be equal to 1/2. Indeed, that's what we get here. If P is equal to Q, then you get P squared divided by 2P squared, and that gives you exactly a 1/2. Now let's see how to solve the problem using sigma-additivity instead. So I just quickly remind you here the answer we found using a conditioning. And using sigma-additivity, so the idea of this technique is going to be to write all the possible outcomes in this event WA, and then again look at the probability of WA and just say that it's the sum of the probabilities of all those individual outcomes. So the first step is to find all the possible outcomes in WA, and I'm going to write those outcomes as a list of A's and B's, but where A, each time there is the letter A, that means that A scores 1 point, and same for B. And so the first thing is to observe that all these outcomes consist of a sequence of an even number of terms. So why is that? Well, that means basically that A and B are going to play for an even number of points. And indeed, if you call, let's say, N the number of points that B scored, then because A wins on this event, that means that at the time they stop, A has scored exactly N plus 2 points, 2 more than B. And so that means that the total number of points they scored is 2n plus 2, which is an even number. So the total number of points they are going to play is even. So that gives you one first information on the set of outcomes. Let me write, for instance, all the outcomes with, let's say, if they play 8 points. So that they play 8 points, it's not possible to start with a double A or a double B, because that would mean that they stop after 2 points. So we have to start with AB, or another possibility is BA. That's the first block should look like this, so that they play 8 points. Then, so that's going to be our first block. Then, second block, it doesn't matter which of the two outcomes we have here. For the second block, we have the same type of block. After the 2 points, the first 2 points, there is a tie. So it's like we restart the game. And then again, you should see AB or BA. And then, so that they go up to 8 points, you need again a third block of this type. So that's going to be again AB or BA. And then, because we want them to play 8 points total, we need to stop here. So if we have again AB or BA, that means that there is a tie after 8 points. And so they need to keep playing. So we need to stop the sequence by a double A or a double B. Of course, we want a double A because we are in the event WA. And so the sequence starts with a double A. So you see, characteristic of all the outcomes is not just that eventually A has 2 more points than B. What we need to do also so that they keep playing is we need to make sure that after each even number of points, there is a tie. So they are tied after 2 points, after 4 points, after 6 points, and then you finish with a double A. So in general, we can call those blocks 1, 2, and so on, up to let's say n, and this one is going to be block n plus 1. And the set of outcomes here consists of a sequence of n blocks of the type AB or BA, and then you end up with a double A. N can be 0 also, because if n equals 0, you don't have any of those blocks and you just start with a double A. That's also in the event WA. So now that we know all the outcomes in WA, we can write the probability of WA. So the probability of WA is going to be exactly, so this infinite sum, and here that I'm using sigma-additivity, I'm going to use the fact that the probability of WA is just equal to the infinite sum of the probability of all the outcomes here. So we said that n can be anything from 0 to infinity, okay? Obviously, they are going to stop playing at some point, but there is no specific bound for n. Nothing says that they have to stop playing at some specific time. They just keep playing until they are 2 points apart. So the sum indeed goes to infinity. And then we have to look at the probability of all those events here. So you see that starting with AB has probability PQ, starting with BA has probability QP. Of course, PQ is equal to QP. So the overall probability of a block like that is exactly 2PQ. So the probability that we start with such a block is 2PQ. By independence, the probability that we see this after is exactly 2PQ squared. In general, so that there is a tie at each even number of points up to 2n. Here it's like they play 2n points. It's going to be exactly 2pq at the power n. So here we have a 2pq at the power n. That's the common probability of those blocks. We need n of them. They are independent. Now, the probability of this last block here is clearly p squared. We want a to win twice in a row. So that's going to be, again, probability of this outcome. Okay, in fact, you have here hidden some kind of 2 at the power n outcomes, because you have A, B, or B, but it's, we take that into account in the 2PQ here. And so that's the common probability of all those 2 at the power n possible outcomes. And then you can just add them up by sigma-additivity. That gives you the probability of WA. So now to conclude, we just need to do a little calculation. So here it's easy. It's just going to be equal to, so the p square does not depend on n. You can put it outside the sum if you want. Then this is just a geometric series with a ratio here 2pq. And so the infinite sum here, and of course 2pq is less than 1, so you have convergence of this infinite sum. This infinite sum is going to be 1 divided by 1 minus the ratio, so it's 1 divided by 1 minus 2pq. Eventually you obtain p squared divided by 1 minus 2pq. So that's the answer we found before. Again, because p plus q is equal to 1, you can again argue that 1 minus 2pq is equal to p squared plus q squared. And you see that using this technique, like using sigma-additivity, you again find the same answer as before. After you write this denominator in another form, p squared plus q squared.